Last month's G20 Summit in Australia came and went without the protests and riots we've come to expect at the summit in recent years. But as author and researcher Ellen Brown notes, the real fireworks happened behind closed doors, where the group rubber-stamped new regulations that will make Cyprus-style bank bail-ins a worldwide reality. This is the GRTV Feature Interview with Ellen Brown and your host, James Corbett. All right, Ellen Brown, let's talk about a series of articles that you've been writing recently that I think are extremely important on the subject of banking regulation. And this, we can pick this story up at the recent G20 meeting, which really didn't create much of a splash in either the mainstream or the alternative media, generally speaking. But there was an important rubber stamping of a piece of, a white paper regulation proposal by a shadowy body known as the Financial Stability Board. Board that very, very few people have ever heard of, but is quietly rewriting the architecture, the infrastructure for global banking regulations behind the scenes. And you start by noting this in an article that I'll refer readers to called New G20 Rules, Cyprus-Style Bail-ins to Hit Depositors and Pensioners. And this is a very important subject, but one that unfortunately it's difficult for a lot of people to wrap their minds around because there's a lot of jargon here, including a white paper from the Financial Stability Board that we'll link to called The Adequacy of Loss-Absorbing Capacity of Global Systemically Important Banks in Resolution, which I defy you to say 10 times quickly in a row. But at any rate, these are the types of rules that are really going to have a significant effect on us. I'm sure the audience is by now very familiar with the idea of banking bailouts as what we saw in the 2008 crisis. But in the event of the next crisis, we may be looking at a bail-in scenario similar to what happened in Cyprus last year. For people who are not familiar with the idea of bail-in, perhaps you can walk us through that and what that actually means in the event of the next global systemic banking collapse?
Well, after the last one, governments balked at bailing out their big banks again. And so, for example, in the U.S., the Dodd-Frank Act said no more bailouts. Of course, they just now changed that, but that's what it said. And so but it didn't say that we're going to just let these banks go bankrupt. It said there's going to be a new way of doing it. You, the banks, are going to have to figure out how to recapitalize yourselves. And so we want to see you come up with living wills. These are like zombie banks coming up with living wills for what they're going to do in the event that they're about to expire. And what they're actually told to do is to confiscate the the assets of their creditors. And this would be their shareholders, their bondholders, and their depositors, which is the largest class of creditor of any bank. Now, theoretically, we're protected by depositor insurance. In the U.S., it would be FDIC insurance. But the FDIC fund, and that, first of all, that only goes up to $250,000. So the people who aren't covered would be businesses, for example, who keep a lot of money. They need a lot of money for their cash flow. They have to pay their payroll and so forth. And in Cyprus, for example, everybody over the deposit limit, which in the Eurozone is 100,000 euros, lost 50% of what they had in the bank. Well, that was a huge hit. And these were mostly businesses, local businesses. So that means they wind up either closing their doors or laying off their employees. So everybody basically got hit. The whole economy got hit. And that's what we'd be looking at as well. I've seen that they're now telling their large depositors, pull your money out of the bank because we don't want it anymore. So now where are they going to go with their money? Of course, my thing is public banking. I think we have to set up our own publicly owned banks. So anyway, the people under $250,000, which would be most of us, are supposedly covered by this FDIC fund, which currently, last time I looked, had $46 billion in it. The problem is that there are $4.5 trillion or so of deposits that are covered by that $46 billion. That's like half of all the deposits, which are close to $10 trillion. So obviously, there's not enough money to cover all the deposits. Theoretically, the FDIC has a $500 billion credit line with the Treasury. But first of all, they have to pay that money back. They're supposed to give this a payment schedule and show how they're going to pay it back. Who's going to pay it back? It's supposed to be the their members who pay premiums. And the last time they had to pay back much, much less, just like a few billion. It was very hard on the small banks, and many of the small banks then wound up either going under or selling out to the larger banks. So they would never be able to bail out a JP Morgan or a Bank of America, which both have over $1 trillion in deposits. And but the big liability is their derivatives. They have there are $280 trillion in derivatives that's the exposure of the US banks. There are six big banks that are there, or five or six big banks that are the big derivatives banks. And so JP Morgan, for example, both JP Morgan and Bank of America have over $50 trillion in derivatives. So if they get hit with a big derivatives loss, then it could well wipe out their deposits. And the problem is that under the Bankruptcy Reform Act of 2005, the derivatives players go first in bankruptcy. So they get to snatch all the collateral before the FDIC even gets in there, or the state and local governments, who they theoretically are secured with collateral, but so are the derivatives players, and they're the ones that get to go first. So they're going to take all the money. And right now, what we're looking at, and why I think there's all this haste to change the rules again, is the collapse in the price of oil, which has gone down by about 50, it's gone down by half, which nobody anticipated. And it's not within, of course, the banks plan for it, they hedge and they plan for all these things when they do their derivatives, but nobody planned for that because it simply was not the result of supply and demand. There's pretty good evidence that it's actually geopolitical warfare against Russia and Iran, but particularly Russia. So that is going. So there are the big banks are the counterparties on all these derivatives that the oil producers buy in order to protect their price. It's just like derivatives. The original derivative was agriculture, where the corn producer would want to guarantee the price of his corn, and he didn't know what it would be several months ahead when the corn finally went to market. So he would lock in a price, and some speculator would take the other side of the bet and agree to pay that price no matter what it really was, betting that it would actually be more than that. So the banks are the counterparties on these oil bets, and they could go very, very wrong. I mean, they obviously already have gone very, very wrong, but there's a certain payout period, so they're not. Some of them must have been due by now, but most of them, I think, are like 3 months and several years ahead. So the oil price will have to go back up very quickly, or somebody's going to lose a lot of money on that. And it turns out now it's going to be us because of this recent change last weekend in the where they took out the one thing that the banks were not allowed to cover were their speculative bets for their own account, which included commodities. So that was like only 5% of their derivatives, but still that works out to $14 trillion in derivatives. It's fair hit, like the size of the federal debt. And that's the part that now is covered, since they squeezed that into this omnibus budget bill.
But lay this out for us, because traditionally the speculative derivative trades of banks have been separated from the commercial banking infrastructure of banks until about a decade and a half ago. Can you walk us through that process and how this became part of the basically one big banking system?
Right. In 1933, Roosevelt passed the Glass-Steagall Act, which said that, of course, at that point, the banks had been wiped out. They had a bank holiday, closed the banks. And when they opened up, it was totally new rules. And one of the rules was that we were no longer on the gold standard. But one of them was that banks were no longer allowed to gamble with their depositors' money. They had to put the depositors' money in one arm or one, you know, they had to be separate banks at that time, I think. So you would have your investment wing over here and your deposits over here. But in 1999 and 2000, that was that act was repealed, supposedly because our banks were losing out on global markets and had to be able to compete. But really, it was actually part of the World Trade Organization rules, where all the countries had to agree to this, to open their banks or open their borders so that all the banks would be under these same rules, because it wouldn't work if only our banks were doing it. Well, that's the same thing that we're seeing with the G20 here. Originally, it was the G7, and I think they probably thought, well, that's not enough countries. We need all the big countries. So they roped all the 20 countries into the G20 as if they were having some sort of control over the rules. But really what it was that it would get them under the thumb of the Financial Stability Board, which would then just do these edicts, and all the countries would have to comply. And they are complying, because they don't seem to know what they're doing. I mean, you know that, like Obama, you can just imagine that he's not real up on the bail-in procedure and so forth. His advisors tell him to sign it, so he signs it. I mean, his job is to do the photo ops and maybe say something rude about the Putin and other leaders that he doesn't like. It, you know, it's all a staged thing for over several days, and nobody looks real closely at these hundreds of pages that they're supposed to put their stamp of approval on.
Let's talk about the process by which this is being implemented in the various G20 countries, because to me, this is the real face of the globalization and the global government threat that we're facing. It's not this idea of some parliament of the world that's meeting or something like this. It's these bodies that most people don't even know exist that are writing these types of white papers on regulatory reforms that are then rubber stamped by the G20 and implemented in each country individually. But it's basically like this Financial Stability Board is writing the global banking regulations for all of the G20 countries, more or less. Let's talk about the FSB, where it came from, and how it is locked into this agenda, and who's really running it anyway.
Well, originally it was the FSF, which was the Financial Stability Forum. That was in 1999, and it was formed after the last crisis, or the crisis before last, the Asian crisis, in order to stabilize the banking system. So then it was just seven countries, the seven largest industrialized countries, and it was merely advisory. But after the 2008 collapse, they enlarged it to be the G20. There was a meeting of the G20 in London, and they all agreed to be bound by the rules of this Financial Stability Board, which is housed in the Bank for International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland. It isn't exactly the BIS, but there's certainly some obvious connections there. And the BIS is itself a very shady entity that started out in 1930 to do settlement of the reparations payments from Germany. But as it turned out, the German central bank pretty much called the shots on the BIS. And anyway, it was very controversial. They were dealing with confiscated gold, et cetera. There was an attempt to get it shut down, but somehow it kind of went underground, and then it reappeared and became it really reappeared when they built this building that was this very unusual looking building that looks like a, it looks like it comes out of a science fiction movie, and it's shaped like a boot. And it's rumored that the boot came from this line out of 1984 where Winston is told something, I can't remember, something about the shape of the future would be, if you want to see the shape of the future, visualize a boot on the necks of the people. And so there we are.
It is such a bizarre story, and one that has really, really been underreported in a lot of ways. There's a couple of good books out there on the subject, but not nearly enough. So the BIS and its shady history and its connections into the FSB and then in the back door to the G20 is a fascinating story in and of itself. But let's put this in concrete terms for people. So we're talking, for example, about what's happening in the oil markets right now and the oil derivatives exposure of the various too-big-to-fail banks that are, of course, now being institutionalized through this various legislation as being too big to fail. Let's imagine a scenario where some of these bets go very wrong and one or two or several of these banks start to go under. What are the chain of events that are likely to take place under this new regulatory framework?
Well, the bank then, let's assume it is oil. The oil, with an oil derivative, if the prices drop $50 and it was guaranteed at whatever, anyway, at $50 higher, they're going to owe $50 on every single barrel of oil. So they're going to owe a huge amount of money, which obviously they don't have. So they will have to try to get that from their creditors under the bail-in plan. So under the latest version of the bail-in plan, they're supposed to have 16 to 20% of their risk-weighted assets in the form of bail-inable, either equity or something that can be bailed in, bonds that can be turned into equity. So these are basically the same kind of bonds that banks have always sold, but now they're going to say somewhere in the fine print that in the event that the bank becomes insolvent, your bond will become equity. In other words, you will then have stock in a bankrupt bank. And the catch is, who buys these bonds? It's basically the pension funds. There are some speculators who buy them, but they're very short term and they're liable to be gone when the big collapse happens. And the pension funds will be left holding the bag. So we, the people, once again, are going to be footing the bill, whether it's in the form of our pension funds or our deposits. But let's assume they do get to the deposits. First, they would take the deposits over $250,000 in the U.S. In Europe, they'll take the deposits over 100,000 euros. The deal in Europe was supposed to, there was this banking union that they agreed to last spring, and it was supposed to be a three-pronged deal where first the bankrupt banks would go, would bail in their creditors' money. And before they would be allowed to go to the bailout fund. All the countries contributed to this bailout fund, but before the banks could get that money, they had to bail in a certain portion of their own creditors' money. And theoretically, there would be the third prong was supposed to be this Europe-wide insurance that would cover the depositors under 100,000 euros. But the only problem was they couldn't agree on the insurance. Of course, Germany did not want to be responsible for Greece and Italy and Spain and all the countries that were liable to cost a fair amount of money. So they don't have the insurance, which is critical to this whole plan. So if you're in one of those southern countries that's very vulnerable and your big banks go bankrupt, your only recourse is going to be to your own government, which at that point no doubt is going to be bankrupt. So it'll be another Cyprus, only in this instance, it'll probably be the ordinary depositors who get hit as well.
It's a very dangerous game of dominoes that's being played right now, and obviously this is a game for all the marbles, and we have to try to avoid this, because as you were saying earlier, probably most of the people listening to this conversation in America will be in one of the big five banks with their deposits, or around the world will be in similar institutions in various countries, like here in Japan, with the largest bank in the world, the Japan Post, which is being privatized as we speak. So there are a lot of systemic problems that are being built in, sort of baked into the cake here, and there has to be a way out of this. You raised the idea of public banking as a solution to this type of crisis. Tell us more about that idea and how that can help to stem this problem before it starts, hopefully.
Well, the one solution that you always hear in Congress is to go to reinstate the Glass-Steagall Act, which would separate investment banking and depository banking, but they haven't managed to pass such a bill, so we can actually do it ourselves. We can have the same effect. We can protect our deposits by setting up our own banks. And if they're now telling the big depositors to pull that they don't even want their money, to pull their money out, where are they going to put their money? We need to set up some banks that are safe, and the easiest way to do it is to set up publicly owned banks where you take the money of the governments, the local government, like let's say California, I've been working on that, of course, because I live in California. So you take the deposits of the government, put it in your own bank. California currently has $54 billion in a treasurer's investment pool earning 0.23% interest. In other words, it's earning almost nothing. You could take, you can't spend that money. This is supposedly rainy day money, but you could invest it. So let's say you bought CDs in your own bank with it, and you could pay them more than 0.23%. And you'd have a huge capital and deposit base that you could leverage for your own economy. For the purposes of your own economy, you could save 50% on the cost of infrastructure, because 50% of the cost of infrastructure is now interest over the course of a 30-year bond. And you could have a safe and secure place for not only your public deposits, but for your private deposits. It just seems to me so obvious that that's what we should do, but it's very hard to move politicians until they're in a crisis. And then you have something like 1933, where the banks close, and when they open, it's a whole new deal. And they say, okay, new rules, we're going to do it this way now. So that may be what it takes, a big crisis.
Well, we often find that big moves don't happen until there's a crisis, but unfortunately, we always find that there's a pre-approved, predetermined solution that's ready and waiting in the wings for those types of crises that generally don't work out in the people's favor. So it is, I certainly resonate with the idea that we have to start taking the bull by the horns and implementing this on our own before it gets to that crisis point. And for the people in the crowd folding their arms and being cynical and saying, well, that's never going to work, we don't have the resources to do this, we can't beat the system, what do you say to those naysayers?
Oh, it actually would be very simple to set up our own bank. So you could do it in a couple of months. They're in Seattle right now. They're working on a publicly owned, city-owned bank in Santa Fe, New Mexico. They're doing a feasibility study on it. So there are movements all over the country, Philadelphia, etc. It's just a matter of the political will. Once you decide to do it, it would be very quick. I mean, private people can set up a bank. There's no reason that a government, which has lots of deposits that they could put into this bank, they can't just, I mean, you don't even need a building. All you have to do is have somebody in your treasury be the bank, and it's really just an accounting function. So the only thing that won't work is getting your politicians to do it. Once you get past that barrier, it's very easy.
All right. Well, let's leave it there for now. Obviously, this is an extremely important subject, so I hope people are following your reporting on this. And obviously, we will direct them to ellenbrown.com. Are there any other places or sources of information you'd like to direct people to?
Well, I have two books on this subject, Web of Debt and The Public Bank Solution, and they're both available on Amazon.
Excellent. All right, Ellen Brown, thank you again for your time, and thank you for this reporting. It's very important, and I'm glad you're doing it.
Oh, thanks, James.
For more on this story and other breaking news and current events, please go to globalresearch.ca. For more research and analysis by James Corbett, please go to corbettreport.com. The Center for Research on Globalization depends on your support. To purchase a book or DVD, or to make a donation, please visit globalresearch.ca today.